moon, Earth's shiny bright orbital that treats us to its burgeoning best every 29.5 days. The moon holds a tidal influence over the world's oceans, and more simply, it reminds us that there are other rocks out there in space. We aren't alone. The Earth and the moon have been together for around 4.5 billion years, but what if another space rock came hurtling at our buddy? What would happen if it was damaged beyond repair? Hello and welcome back to Life's Biggest Questions, the channel that does not believe that curiosity killed the cat. We believe it made it stronger and more fierce. I'm your host Rebecca Felgate, and today I'm asking, what if an asteroid destroyed the moon? By now, I think we all know that I love the moon. I'm a moon fan. I have a moon app on my phone, and I'm scripting this video the day after a new moon. Hello, moon. Do let me know if you guys have any strong opinions about the moon too, and also, do let me know if you think that humans will ever live on the lunar surface. I honestly don't think they will because it's very, very cold, but I suppose you can never say never. Do let me know all of your thoughts in the comment section down below, and also, why not leave a few moonmojis? Make sure you leave a thumbs up on this video and share it with a fellow moon enthusiast. Also, do stick around to the end where I'll be reading some comments from a previous video. It is thought that planet Earth formed around 4.54 million years ago, and around 400,000 years later, the moon formed as a result of an astronomical body the size of Mars smashing into planet Earth, with the monumental debris forming our fave shiny sky buddy. Since then, the moon and Earth's relationship has been rock solid. We can tell by looking at the moon that it has been hit with asteroids before. Unlike Earth, the moon has no atmosphere, no tectonic activity, and no erosion. All of the impacts that it has experienced are still visible on its surface. It's actually thought that the moon helps attract asteroids, so less hit Earth. But what if it bore the brunt of impact simply too big to survive? There have been concerns in recent years that large asteroids passing by the Earth could pelt our beautiful moon. In November 2011, for example, 2005 YU55 passed by the Earth inside the orbit of the moon, but luckily the moon was a fourth of its way to the opposite side of the Earth, meaning that they missed one another by 150,000 miles. That being said, even if they had hit, it really wouldn't have been a big deal in the grand scheme of things. The asteroid was only the size of 4 football fields, so really, as there is no life on the moon, the most damage it would have been was to be causing a small crater on an already pockmarked surface. The moon's biggest impact crater is the South Pole Aitken Basin, which is a whopping 1,600 miles wide and 8.1 miles deep. It's one of the biggest known impact craters in our observable solar system, which means the moon has got a real smashing once. This was thought to have happened 3.9 billion years ago during a period called the Late Heavy Bombardment, a time in which unusual gravitational dynamics in our infant solar system led to a large number of astrological impacts. Our moon has had its fair share of drama, sure, but it would take a nearly moon-sized object to actually destroy our orbital. Back in 2011, when people were worrying about the 2005 YU55 event, NASA's Don Yeoman, the director of Near-Earth Object Program Office, spoke out to quell concerns. He said that only something not a whole lot smaller than the moon itself could do any kind of real damage. He also noted that there are no asteroids large enough to do it that we know of. The largest asteroid that we do know of is Ceres, which lives in the asteroid belt between Mars and Jupiter. Ceres is technically recognized as a dwarf planet, and it is over a quarter of the size of the moon. While a collision with the moon may knock it out of its orbit, moving it closer or maybe even further away from Earth, unless it was traveling at some serious, serious speed, the moon would survive. But okay, enough reality, Rebecca. This isn't what we're here for. We want to know what would happen if an asteroid astronuked the moon. Okay, I'll give it to you. The moon explosion would be quite the spectacle for those who got to see it at night. Some people would manage to capture it on camera with long lenses, and the images would be infamous. People would better not spend too much time staring at the sky though, as moon chunks would be on our weather report, and we may want to all duck and cover. Smaller chunks would likely burn up in the atmosphere before hitting Earth, but the rest would rain down on us, depending on how big they were. And depending on how big they were, they could flatten buildings or perhaps even towns. I imagine there would be a death toll, but how high would depend on whether or not we knew an asteroid was gonna hit the moon and how heavily we were prepared for the catastrophe of the moon rocks raining. Long term, we actually really would feel the effects of our moon loss. Most of us will know that the moon is a tide controller. While the sun does have a gravitational effect on our water bodies, the much closer moon is the biggest influencer. Without the moon, tides would be 40% the size they are today. At the moment, tidal flows mix ocean waters which spread nutrients to marine life. Minimizing that process would damage ocean health, meaning a further depletion in ocean life. This would also mean that humans have less fish as a food source, which may continue the current worrying trend of unsustainable cattle farming, which is damaging the atmosphere and encouraging drought. Nocturnal animals would also be affected. Moonlight helps both prey and predators alike. Our skies would also be pretty dark, and I know for one, I would absolutely miss the monthly full moon. While a lot of modern day scientists are very skeptical about this, we have a long history of associating human behavior with various phases of the moon, so I do wonder how we would fare mentally without it. The moon acts as a bit of an anchor to the Earth. Whilst it definitely orbits us, its gravity provides us with some stability. Without the moon, the Earth may wobble on its axis, which would mean inconsistent weather, as the sun would shine more erratically on various parts of our Earth. Long term, this would affect climates, as our normal process of heating and cooling is disturbed. The Earth may spin slightly faster too, making our years somewhat shorter. If Miss Moon was destroyed by asteroids, we would likely be more exposed to them ourselves. A lot of people do think that the moon protects Earth from intergalactic peltings. How long would it be until we met the same fate as our lunar buddy? And of course, an asteroid to Earth, what with all the people living and walking around, is much more catastrophic than the moon, where, so far as we know, there is no life. So the long and short of it is that, yes, it's very unlikely that our moon could be destroyed by an asteroid. If it was, then our oceans would change, as would our day-to-day weather. We may lose fish, and that would cause wider repercussions, and things might get wobbly. But again, don't worry, because it's very unlikely. The largest asteroid we know of is far away, and still even then unlikely to destroy something so large as our moon. So what did you guys think to this video? Do you feel a lot of moon pride? Are you glad the moon exists? What a question. I know that I love the moon, but do let me know your thoughts in the comment section down below. Although I do love it, I wouldn't want to live there though, because it is just too cold, and I've survived Canadian winters, but I just don't think I could do it year round on the blooming moon. Alright, before I go, I'm just gonna read some comments from What If Our Sun Turned Into a Strange Star? Strange Star! If you guys haven't watched that video yet, then please do so, it was super interesting. Dr. Lander said, "What if the sun has an evil twin with an evil beard?" I don't even really know where to go with that, but good question, thank you. Now I'm thinking of the sun wearing a beard, but the fire and the flames, ah! Eric Mattison said, "You're smart. You keep talking about things light years away as if you know anything about it, which is literally impossible, except for how it looks. So you're not smart, just an insistent pantomath." Do you know what, Eric? Time and space are relative to our understanding. With your line of thinking, i.e. everyone focused on the here and now, we would never have made any societal progression. Don't get me wrong, Christopher Columbus was a douche, and I'm sure that Leif Erikson had some dubious qualities, but what would have happened if our historical explorers and pals thought, you know what, sailing across the Earth sounds a bit far, or if NASA were like, ooh, the moon, sounds like effort. Before Buzz Aldrin and Neil Armstrong took a little stroll up there, NASA had already a lot of moon theories focusing and floating around. Before Spirit and Opportunity roved Mars, we already had hypothesized about its surface, and we've done so for hundreds of years. It's okay to talk about theories, even if you can't prove them yet. Doing our best with observable information is how we learn, and seeking to one day verify a truth inspires our sense of determination and imagination. Like I said, Eric, curiosity didn't kill the cat, it made it wiser. Evolution is the expansion beyond our bubble. If we always looked inward, we would never grow. Theorizing is a key part of human development. Sure, we can't travel beyond our sun yet, but 20,000 years ago, traveling much beyond our own villages seemed like a stretch too, and this is the point, Eric. I'd like to propose that intelligence isn't just based on the ability to regurgitate practically observable truths, but also a person's ability to imagine. All of the great geniuses throughout time have been expert imaginers. And while this channel may be ridiculous at times, thank Frog for our ability to dream. So, thank you for listening to my TED Talk. I've been your host, Rebecca Felgate. Please do leave a thumbs up on this video and click the notification bell to be the first to hear about future ones. Until then, please do stay curious, stay imaginative, and of course, never, ever stop questioning.